Good morning. Cool crowd. Happy Friday. It's Friday, right? Is it Friday? All right. It's finally Friday, September 2nd. It's Future U event. Welcome to the University of North Florida's Lazar Theater. Beautiful theater. Thank you for joining us this morning. Thank you for all of you. You guys, most of us have jobs here, so we're busy. Thank you for taking just a couple hours out of your day this morning to spend time with us here at Future Home Loans and with Nick Lavery coming in to talk here in just a few minutes. Rob and I are the only things in between you and hearing maybe one of the most incredible people I've talked to this morning, Nick Lavery. He's been on a couple of our meetings the last couple months. I think some of the stories he's going to tell you are going to be pretty inspiring. Today is about growing. It's about achieving and inspiring. So we'll start with my story, which is not going to be anywhere near any of the stories you're going to hear from Nick. My name is Andy Fulton. I'm the president of sales of Future Home Loans. There's a lot of really familiar faces in the crowd, so it's great to see you guys this morning. Again, thank you for coming out to support us. I've been with this organization for about a year and a half. Thank you, Rob, by the way. But I want to tell you a little bit of story going back maybe 20 years ago. I didn't grow up in Jacksonville, but I think of Jacksonville as my home. It's an incredible town. I came here back in 1994 to attend college at Flagler. Did I hear one clap for Flagler College? Yeah. We've got an undefeated football program. After I graduated, I didn't know what I wanted to do, so I got a job in Jacksonville, and that's one of the great things about this town. It has got a great mix of good, large corporations that provide a lot of employment here. This town has a lot of great small business, and it is an incredible community for active service members and veterans. There's three large bases here, and I think anybody that's ever served at these bases do the same things the Jacksonville Jaguars do. They stay in town because they love it so much. So did we. I met my wife here. I met her at work. Hi, Diane. We have two daughters. We raised them here in Jacksonville, Florida. They're 20 and 18 years old. But one of the first jobs I had was with Merrill Lynch Credit Corporation, a really great employer here in town, and eventually they outsourced to PHH. And when they outsourced to PHH Mortgage, things got different. Technology improved. Competition in the work environment improved. Pay in this town improved. And it was one of the most incredible career experiences I've had in my life. And there's many of you that worked at PHH here with me today. And I remember being pretty good. I was a loan officer for PHH. I did well. I was happy with the money I was making, but I was never great. I was pretty good. A few years into that job, I got an opportunity to interview for a leadership position. And I was pretty confident in myself. I believed in myself. And I'd already figured before I even applied for it, it was mine. I'd already won it in my own head. However, there was this other guy not sitting too far from me that was a few years younger than me. He was straight out of West Point. And this guy was beautiful. He's tall, 6'1". His hair was always perfect. His face was perfect. He drove a beautiful truck. He was from West Point, so he knew what a gig line was. And if you're from the military, you know, like, he ironed his jeans on Friday. Well, a few weeks later, I learned he got the job I didn't. And then I learned very quickly after that, not only did he win the job over me, I was going to be assigned to his team. And not only was I going to be assigned to his team, I was actually going to sit right next to him in a cubicle office. It's like, they're messing with me, man. This is crazy. How'd this guy beat me? I know he's pretty, but how did he beat me? So, you know, there was a little tension between the two of us, and he pulls me aside, and he's like, hey, man, I'm just thankful I've got you on my team. And I'll do everything I can to support you in your career. My job was like, yeah, thanks, Chris. Have a good day. And then he got serious with me. He says, hey, tell me what you want to do. What are your goals? I was like, Chris, there's three things I want from you. This is it. This is what I want from my leader. I want you to leave me alone and let me do my job. Leave me alone. I don't want to hear from you. Just leave me. Please leave me alone. I want you to be there when I need you. And then I just lastly want you to tell me I'm doing a good job. I don't want to hear anything else. Just tell me I'm doing a good job. That's all I need. He's like, all right, Andy, I hear you, but you can be better. So when you're ready, let me know. I was like, oh, yeah, sure, I can be better, Chris, thanks. You're the one that's going to help me be better. We joked about it from time to time. The tension came down. I'd come in, not every morning, but a lot of mornings, he'd say, are you ready yet? Are you ready to be better? I'd say, yeah, sure. No, you're not going to help me. You're younger than me. You don't know what you're talking about. And so I was stubborn. And then maybe 6 months goes by, and I'm having that week. If you've ever been in sales, you know the week I'm talking about. Your business is canceling on you. You have no idea where your next deal is going to come from. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, all goose eggs. By Thursday, I'm in panic mode driving to work going, all right, I have an accounting degree. Maybe I need to go back to school, get my CPA. This is over. It's not me. It's the business. It's over. I don't know what I'm going to do. I got into the office. Chris knew it. He knew what kind of week I was having. And he says, you ready now? I said, I think so. Come on. Whatever. Whatever. Either you can help me or I'm going to quit, one or the other. It was a little bit of an overreaction. He says, all right, I'm going to sit with you today. I'm going to plug into you. I'm going to listen to your sales calls. I'm going to give you feedback. And I already know, because I've been doing a lot of work on you without talking to you for the last 6 months, there's one thing I want you to work on. I said, what is it, Chris? He goes, I need you to shut up. You talk too much. I still have that problem. I said, all right. So he says, I'm going to make a little thing. I'm going to do this. And every time you're talking, every time you're explaining and over-explaining to people and boring them, I'm going to do this. And so he starts doing that to me. He's sitting right next to me. He's doing this right in my face. I'm like, stop. I got to tell him. I got to explain it. And then maybe an hour or two goes by, and I try it. I'm like, I stop. I just stop talking when he tells me to stop talking. And all of a sudden, I start getting some yeses from clients. And by the end of the day, nothing magical had happened, but I kind of saw where he was going. I wasn't ready to give him credit for it yet, but I was starting to learn from him. The next day I came in, he says, I'm coming back. I'm sitting down with you. You okay with it? I was like, we don't need to. He's like, no, we need to. It takes time to build a habit. So he sat with me the next day, and a habit started to form. And by the end of that week, I was having a very different conversation and a very different relationship with Chris. And I was asking him for more feedback. Because by the end of that week, I about had the best week I'd had in months. When I grew up, you know, my birthday's in December, and back in the 80s, there was no September cutoff, right? If you were a December 22 baby, you were the youngest kid in your class. I was always the shortest. I was always the youngest. I was never the fastest. There was nothing I was ever number one at in my life. And when Chris worked with me, it took a few months. I hit number one on a sales board in that company for the first time in my life. And if anybody in here has ever been number one at anything, you know how that feels. It's incredible. It's addictive. And I give that to Chris. And what Chris did for me in that time frame in my career, and thank God it happened at the time when it did, I was still young for this to happen, is I already believed in myself, but somebody else believed in me too. And somebody helped me become coachable. And somebody helped me listen to somebody else and take advice. And if it wasn't for him, and it wasn't for that moment in my career, I would not be standing on the stage with you today. So he's not here today, but I need to thank Chris. I haven't talked to him in probably 20 years. Okay, enough about me. That's what today's going to be. You guys are going to hear a lot cooler stuff than that. But today's about growing. Today's about, you know, most of us, if you still work, most of your days you're spending working. A lot of times you're tired. You're just getting the job done. Try and do the best you can. I'd say most of the times we know when we're doing a great job, but a lot of days we're just getting through our work. That's not what today's about. Today's about taking two steps back, listening. Think about being on your business today, not in your business today. What can you take away today that can help you learn something, help you grow, and help you make different goals for yourself this year or next year, and believe in yourself and surround yourself with people like Chris that are going to help you get there. I was fortunate enough to start surrounding myself with top 1%ers a year and a half ago. When I worked in Jacksonville back in 2012 to 2014 for Bank of America, I had an incredible opportunity to build a sales force and a sales team out there. And there was incredible talent. A lot of it's in this room today. Two of those people, about 5 years ago, broke away from corporations and started betting on themselves a bit more. They already believed in themselves. They'd already outperformed. Now it was time to make big bets on themselves. And they started Future Home Loans. Nick Walker, Mary Walker are in the audience somewhere. Wave, you guys know them. But I've got Rob Lynn, CEO of Future Home Loans here. And when he called me a year and a half ago, while I was watching what they were doing on social media, I was talking to Rob when I came into town to see my parents. I'd have lunch with him. I loved the culture, I loved the energy, and I love to see people that I know did really well working for corporations, making other people a lot of money, starting to bet on themselves a little bit more, and do a better job for the clients that they have been servicing for the last 20 years. So I want to welcome Rob Lynn. Thank you.
Hello.
And I'm going to give Rob Lynn a few minutes to share some messages with you guys.
Good morning. Thanks, Andy. I remember when I slid into Andy's DMs a year and a half ago. He was our site leader, my boss's boss's boss. So there was out of 300 or 400 LOs there. He was in charge of the whole thing. But I talked to Nick. I said, if we're going to grow, we're going to scale, you know, we need to make a move here. And I said, let's talk to the sharpest, most emotionally intelligent person we knew. And it was Andy. So I said, Andy, I'd be way too embarrassed to ask you if you had any interest in this position. So this is me not asking. And then he responded, well, this is me not answering. Let's talk about it. The rest is history. You know, we started growing and scaling. But, I'm very excited to be here today with you guys. I want to thank everybody for coming out. Texts from our team started rolling in at 4 a.m. this morning. Prophet was in the gym, waking everybody up. But, you know, we're excited. We've had Nick on 2 team meetings here over the last 3 months, and he's got everybody fired up on our team, and we want to share that with you guys. Thanks to our business partners, family, friends for coming out, and all our supporters and business partners for showing up here. Showing up matters to us. Special thanks to all our sponsors that kind of helped put this on with us. I want to send a special shout out to UWM, our goal sponsors. They've partnered with us since day one, and they had their leadership team come down, work with us, all the way from Michigan. You know, they've been with us since day one, and we appreciate all you do, and, you know, showing up for us really matters, so we appreciate that. I want to talk a quick minute about our team. You know, Andy told you his story. You know, 5 years ago, I was just sick and tired. You know, the corporate America sucked. Technology was slow. We treated customers poorly. Like, there has to be a better way to do this. We're way too talented to be sitting around doing this path. You know, so we changed it. We knew there was a better way. And 5 years later, you know, we've got over 100 teammates here with us at Future Home Loans. We're the top mortgage broker in the Southeast. We're a top 20 mortgage broker in the entire country. And we're growing. You know, and this year's been tough for us in our market. You know, rates have gone up, supply's been low, housing costs have gone up, inflation. It's been hard, but we've grinded through this. You know, it's easy to look good when everything's going great for you, but what's hard is to grind through the tough times. And we've grown, we're up 12% year over year, while everybody else in our industry's down 30-40%. That's what I'm really proud of, and I'm proud of my team here. Future fam, thank you for making this possible and getting Nick Lavery here. Now, special thanks to our marketing team, Mary and her team. They put on a great event. It's been awesome. Thank you so much. We really appreciate you. Next, I want to talk about our veteran community real quick. You saw a lot of our veteran community leaders out in the hallway. They're joining us here today. I served back in the 90s. So it's more like the Boy Scouts compared to what's going on now. You know, people say thank you for your service. I get a little embarrassed because, you know, I got a lot more out of them than they got out of me. But, you know, I do want to thank all of our veterans here. If y'all could take a second, maybe stand up. Let's give you a round of applause. Yeah, we appreciate all you do, and thank you guys for coming and joining us. I do want to send a special shout out to one of my best friends, Taylor. We've been best buddies since we first started in the military 30 years ago, believe it or not. I don't look it, but yeah, it was a long time ago. We met, I got him in trouble his first week on base, and we've been best friends ever since. No matter where we've traveled, wherever we go, he's always there for us. So thanks for showing up, Taylor. Appreciate you. He introduced me to Nick Lavery. He was in the same circles with Nick over the last few years. And, you know, I started hearing some of the stories about what this dude's accomplished. And, you know, it's amazing. And his book came out and I read it. I'm like, I got to meet this guy. I'm like, Mary, plan me an event just so I can meet this dude. He's amazing. You know, so thank you for getting that together for us and letting us do this. You know, lastly, I want to talk about a couple things I want you to take away here. You know, everybody's going to leave this place inspired. This dude's freaking inspiring. You know, but inspiration without execution leaves you exactly where you are. So where are you guys going to be, you know, 2 weeks, 2 months, 2 years from now? I want you to take away a few things here and put it into practice. A couple quick things for me, and then I'll let you get back on with it and bring out the prized possession, but always focus on the positive. You know, it sounds cheesy, but it works. You know, you let negativity creep in, it's going to ruin your day, your week. Get rid of the excuses, the alibis, no complaining, focus on winning, not listening to people complain. How do you get started? You know, you got to set a goal and then make a plan. That's the only way you're going to get any execution. So I want you to leave here with a few goals in mind. You know, Nick inspired me when I first met him 4 months ago. Like, I'm going to be on stage with this dude. I got to start freaking working out. I'm not going to show up and be a fat ass in front of this guy, you know. So it was awesome to walk around here and people say, hey, you look great. You lost the weight. Yeah. Thanks, Nick. You inspired me. Do that for you, whether it's business, personal, school, family, whatever you want to do, you know. Set a plan, set a goal, and you can accomplish it. And then the last is my real secret to success, besides what Andy said about having two ears and one mouth. So I'm going to be a little quicker than him. You got to use it appropriately. It's consistency. It's doing it every day. You know, touchdowns are scored on Sundays, but it's the stuff that happened during the week that leads to that. It's every day getting up and doing it. Every day making a habit. Inches make feet. Feet make yards. Yards make touchdowns. So that's how you win the game, is be consistent every day. Yeah, it's not very glamorous, but that's my secret to success. You know, and thank all you guys again for showing up. It matters to us. We appreciate you. And the future's bright. Right on.
All right, let me introduce Nick Lavery. Hopefully you guys saw him. By the way, he's going to be out there signing books. They brought books with them. If you don't have one, they're going to be selling books out there as well. This guy is a machine. I felt short before I met him.
They didn't know the gram, it didn't happen.
Rob just recorded my shortness. Thank you. Well, he'll be out and about. I encourage you to stop by, introduce yourself, get to know him. Let me tell you about Nick. Nick is currently serving the United States citizens as a Special Forces Warrant Officer, Assistant Detachment Commander, and is widely recognized as an experienced subject matter expert in special operations, intelligence fusion, and mission planning and execution across all operational continuums. Some of the awards that Nick has been accommodated with include the Silver Star, 3 Purple Hearts, 2 Bronze Stars, Bronze Star with V for Valor, Defense Meritorious Service Medal, 2 Meritorious Service Medals, Joint Service Commendation Medal, Joint Service Achievement Medal, Army Connection Medal, the OSS Society Peter Ortiz Award, and the Special Operations Commander Excalibur Award. That's a lot. It's probably more than all of us in this room combined. I want to give a big round of applause to Nick Lavery.
All right. How's the audio? You guys hear me? All right, perfect. So, Rob mentioned I've had the opportunity over the last couple months to do some one-on-one virtual engagements with him and his team. This is the first time I've met any of these people in person. Get in here, no introductions, how you doing, good to meet you, thank you, no thank you, no thank you, no thank you, right, that whole thing. And, you know, give me a tour of the place, checking it out, seeing what we're working with here. And I asked Andy, I said, hey, man, so how do you feel about this so far? And he kind of did one of these, like, you know. I said, that's perfect, man. That's exactly where you want to be. Because this is the first time that these guys have done anything like this. And it's nerve-wracking. And you're nervous. And you're scared. You put a lot of time and energy into something. And you don't know if it's going to work. And I said to him, I said, hey, man, that right there is exactly where this should be. Because if you made it through an event like this, or really anything in general, and there aren't mistakes, there aren't failures, there aren't times where you just want to kick yourself in the ass, then it was just a massive missed opportunity. Because you either set the bar too low, or you just weren't moving with enough aggression. You had more in the tank that went unfulfilled, unutilized. So in that, quickly, to Rob, Andy, Mary, the rest of the team, can we just give them a quick round of applause for the work that they've done here? Fantastic venue. Thank you for the invitation, for having me be a part of this. Really, really special. Andy gave the introduction. Nick Lavery, active duty member, United States Army Special Forces, more commonly referred to as the Green Berets. I've been doing this now just past 15 years, and although the Army and the military, if you don't come from this organization or this industry, it's confusing. There's a lot of different ranks and branches and ways to do things. I understand that. I could spend 4 hours up here trying to explain that dichotomy, and you would still be left confused, because I've been doing it 15 years, and I'm still confused about a lot of it. But what I do want to touch on is what I do, or at least a piece of what I do as a chief warrant officer. And although there's a lot of doctrinal responsibilities that I have, there's a lot of roles and duties that I fulfill, the primary one is that of an advisor. All right, I'm an advisor to decision makers. I'm an advisor to commanders. And the way I do that, the way we do that as Special Forces warrant officers is through our experience and our level of expertise, which is built over time through thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of hours of repetition at doing different tasks. The number one method, the number one aspect that we use to provide that counsel, to provide that advice, that guidance, is risk. It's risk management, or better put, risk calculus is how we do that. And there's a lot of different tools and methods that we're taught on how to use these different practices to enable us to do risk calculus. But really, at the end of the day, it boils down to two options: risk of action and risk of inaction. I'm going to come back to that here as we move forward in time. Lastly, before I kind of get into some of my history, some of the experiences I've had, just really set the tone and kind of give you guys some context. Those of you that are taking notes mentally, written, on your phone, feel free, is this. This is the bottom line up front of what we're going to discuss here right now for the next 30, 45 minutes. And that is, the size of the goal is commensurate with the size of the struggle. The size of the goal is commensurate with the size of the struggle. They're equal. Born and raised in Boston, Mass., for those of you that haven't figured that out yet. I put this up front early often because it is the most important part of what makes me me, and that is my family. My wife, also active duty, United States Army, and we've been blessed with two small boys. They're small now, small-ish. Should say young. Oldest is 5, youngest is 17 months. And they are deeply rooted in the why behind what I do, how I do it. Highlight of my life. We'll move quickly kind of through time to get past my stuff so we can get to what really matters here, and that's your guys' stuff. So I originally began looking at military service around high school. I believe it was my sophomore year. I didn't have much direction. And I skipped school one day. I went downtown Boston. I met with a Marine Corps recruiter. And I said, I think I want to be a Marine. And he said, perfect. Graduate high school, come back, see me, we'll get you in. I said, okay, thank you. So I had kind of a direction. Horrible academic. I excelled in athletics, but I did the bare minimum in school. So I had kind of a game plan. What detracted me from that was my junior year of high school, I started getting recruited to play football. And then my senior year of high school, I really started getting recruited to play football. So I ultimately went that route, went up to the University of Massachusetts at Lowell, played ball up there, D2 program. If it wasn't for athletics, if it wasn't for football, I would have almost certainly enlisted in the military right out of high school. So my sophomore year of college, one day I'm walking to class, which was kind of rare for me, and all of the students are walking back towards the dorms. And I stop one dude. I'm like, hey, man, what's going on? He's like, yeah, all the classes have been canceled today. And I'm like, perfect. I didn't want to go anyway. I don't even know why I'm here now, to be honest with you. Fantastic. So I'm heading back towards my dorm, just thinking about how I'm going to totally waste yet another day. Get back to my dorm, click on the television, and the same thing is on every single channel. And those are planes that are flying into the World Trade Center in New York. And I can still envision that exact moment, as many of you probably can as well, a moment that most of us won't forget. And I remember sitting there watching American citizens make the choice between burning to death or jumping out of a building to their death. And although at that time I was certainly proud to be an American, I wasn't raised in a robust military family. I didn't have the red, white, and blue coursing through my veins the way I do today, but I was angry. I was really, really angry. And in that moment, I struggled to stay in school. I knew what was going to happen. I could foresee what was going to happen, and I very much wanted to be part of that response. Listened to some advisors, some mentors, some family. I ultimately stayed in school. I grinded out my degree, and then upon graduation, began looking at options to enter military service. This is now 2006, 2007. Afghanistan's going on. Iraq is going on. A lot of American citizens, service members, are coming home in bags and with different varying degrees of injuries. And my desire to get into that fight was the same that it had been, you know, just a handful of years prior. I knew I wanted to be in special operations. I felt that my physical capability would be best suited there. But more significantly, I wanted to make as much of an impact as a single human being could make. I wanted to be at the very front of the fight, and that is why we have our Special Operations Enterprise. Began looking at options. Originally, I was going to become a Navy SEAL. When you guys think of the most elite, badass warrior on the planet, the Navy SEALs tend to come to mind really, really fast. Went in, said, hey, I think I want to be a SEAL. Guy said, great, let's get you enlisted in the Navy, and then you can request to go be a SEAL after. I said, thank you, I left. I talked to a Marine Corps recruiter, got the same answer, walked in the Army's office, got a different answer. He said, we have this program, it's called Special Forces Recruit Contract Option, which gives guys off the street the opportunity to bypass the conventional Army entirely and go straight into Army Special Forces. That was enticing. I didn't commit because I still wasn't sure what Green Berets did, what SF detachments did. I went home, I did some research, and I was drawn to not only the speed in which that option would get me into the fight, but also our core mission, and that is of unconventional warfare. So that was the route I went. Went back a couple days later, signed a contract. A few months later, I was at basic training down in Fort Benning, Georgia. Went through the entire process of selection, assessment, the qualification course. Ended up being just over 2 years, 2.5 years of training, and then I officially became a Green Beret. 4 or 5 months after that, I was in Afghanistan for the first time with my team conducting combat operations. Come back from that, reset, train. At this point in my life, nothing mattered to me more than being the best Special Forces operator possible. It was really on that first deployment into Afghanistan that I fell in love with this business. I fell in love with this industry. And when I talk about passion and falling in love with something, I'm really referring to falling in love with the game of being that entity in that profession. Like falling in love with the game, falling in love with the process of being one and striving to be a better one. I caught the bug for it. And although initially I wanted to come in, do my 5-year contract, go to Afghanistan, kick some ass, get some satisfaction out of that for 9/11, that was going to be it for me. But after 9 months in Afghanistan on my first rotation, I couldn't imagine doing anything else. It was in that moment that I realized that, one, I love this, and two, I was put on this earth to do this. Passion, purpose, something we'll come back to in a second. My third time in Afghanistan, which is actually my second combat rotation, a year later, this is now 2012, I was wounded in combat on 3 separate occasions. Same deployment. The first time, I took some grenade shrapnel to the back of my shoulder, blew about a lemon-sized hole in it. Really wasn't that big of a deal, you know, patched it up. I ended up getting medevaced out much later on, got some medical treatment, and then I was back with my team about a week later. A couple months after that was when I was wounded for a second time when I took an AK-47 round to my face, which is something that you don't hear very often. Someone saying, I was shot in the face, because usually those people don't live. I was obviously very lucky, where it just grazed the side of my face, side of my cheek, ripped open a hole, much uglier than it really was. That also took me out of the fight about a week, and then I was back, just back to work. At this point, it's November of 2012. We were working out of a location in the Jalrez district of Wardak province, Afghanistan, and our camp sat at around 7,700 feet. So at that elevation, in that area of the world, come November, December, the snow comes in. I mean, feet of snow, like real snow. I'm from Massachusetts, and I've never seen snow like this. So really, no one can do much of anything operations-wise. Everything just kind of slows down. We kick things back off around February, and then we were set to rotate out with the team coming in to replace us at the end of March. Well, about 2-3 weeks prior to that is when I was wounded for the third time. And this was the result of what we refer to as a green-on-blue incident, which is a military term for an insider attack. Meaning that one of the guys that we had been training and conducting operations with turned on us. So we were getting ready to go on a relatively massive mission. This member of the Afghan National Police Force climbed up on the back of a Ford Ranger pickup truck, which had a truck-mounted PKM machine gun, which is a massive belt-fed machine gun, and opened fire into my team and I from about 20 feet away. It's a devastating weapon. That weapon system can cause massive damage from 700 meters away. There was an infantry soldier who was there with us, who was set to come out on this mission as a driver. And when the rounds clacked off from behind me, I was originally walking away. I heard the rounds, I turn my head around, I see what's happening, I process it, and I see this soldier who's just frozen. And rather than doing my job, rather than doing what I'm supposed to do, which is move to a piece of cover, which is something that can stop bullets, and eliminate this threat, Rather than doing that, I moved towards this kid, this soldier. My love of a teammate superseded my professional responsibility. So take a few steps, get towards him. We go chest to chest. I put my back towards the shooter, and that was when I was hit for the first time. Boom. Hits me right on my upper leg, knocks me down on top of him. I feel myself get hit another handful of times. I'd been wounded before. I was familiar with being shot, with being blown up. We had been through a lot on this deployment. I don't know the severity of it, but I know that I'm wounded. Drag myself and this soldier about 6 feet or so behind a truck. One of my teammates comes in and eliminates that problem. This was the initiation of a complex ambush. So when he kicked things off, we began receiving rockets and machine gun fire from outside of our perimeter. I'm in no position to address any of those problems, so I move to my next course of action, which was to check the status of the soldier that I'm laying on top of, which I do. He has no holes in him. He can breathe. He can talk. So he's relatively fine. He's in shock, but he's going to be fine. Now I need to see what I'm dealing with. Ripped my pant leg open, and my right leg was just hammered meat. It looked like it was put through a meat grinder. Exposed bone, tissue. The docs estimated I was hit 4, maybe 5 times just in my right leg alone. So it was mangled. And I can see the blood flowing from me to where I was originally hit. And it's a river. So I know my femoral artery has been severed, which is a problem. I figure I have maybe 8 or 9 minutes before I'm completely bled out. So I grab a tourniquet, I put that on, I wrench it down as tight as I can, I strap it in, bleeding doesn't stop. Second tourniquet off my kit, boom, slap that on, wrench it down as high as I can. Looks like the bleeding may have slowed down a little bit, but not near enough. One of my teammates gets to me, and the look on his face pretty much said everything that I had really already known, which is, you are going to die here right now. This is where things end. Make no mistake about it. I knew this was the case. So he goes to work, and while he's working on me, I'm trying to get him away from me. I'm trying to fight him off. I'm like, no, dude, you're wasting your time right now. There's this little thing that we like to refer to as triage, which is essentially the process of taking casualties and putting them in different categories based on priority, so that those that are working medically on these people know who to start with and in what order to go. I know I'm in what we call the expectant category, which is the people that aren't going to live. And you are wasting precious time and resources on me when you need to be working on someone else that can be saved. There were 12 Americans on the ground around me. 3 ultimately were killed. So I know that it's a full-blown mass casualty scenario that we're dealing with. My teammate, Jason, he ignores me. He puts a third tourniquet on. He gets IV access for follow-on blood or meds. And at that point, his work was pretty much done. We say our goodbye for the last time, and he moves on. I'm laying there, and I'm going, have I really done everything I can do? I grab my leg. My femur was completely shattered. I pick it up, and I can see blood is still seeping out of the wound. So I said, okay, Mia, you might have a few minutes left here before this is game over. Have you done everything you can do? No, you haven't. So I grab some gauze out of my kit. I ball it up into what we call a power ball, which basically just takes flimsy gauze and gives it a little bit of density. I loosen up one of the tourniquets. I ram this up into my leg, kind of up towards my hip. I'm trying to feel for the pulse of the femoral artery. And although I've done this in training, I've never done it on myself. And when you're bleeding at that rate, your blood shunts inward to protect your organs. So my hands are completely numb. I have no dexterity. I'm working with these like meat mittens. And I'm trying to feel for this pulse. I'm scraping past broken bone. I'm on the verge of going unconscious. It's starting to get real sparkly. Peripheral vision's going away. I'm just talking to myself like, come on, man, stay awake, stay awake, stay awake, stay in the fight. I think I feel something. I push down as hard as I can. I feed the rest of the gauze on top of it, secure. on top, lock it back in, then I go unconscious. I come to maybe a minute later, and I know my work medically is done. I'm at the end of my capability. So I drag myself maybe 5 or 6 feet over to where some of my teammates were laying on the ground. They had been wounded. I crawled up next to our senior medic, Elliot. He had taken a round through his calf. He had been treated, nothing life-threatening, but he's in a lot of pain. So I just decided that in my last moments on earth, I would just spend trying to comfort him. That was the best use of the limited time I had left. I go unconscious. I come to him being loaded on a helicopter. I get flown to an aid station, not a hospital. I get flown to an aid station because it was closer. I need a blood transfusion bad, which I'm put on. Myself, my teammate, and another guy were on this first lift. Blood's on board. A couple seconds go by, minutes goes by, I begin to crash. My entire body starts to go down. Liver is failing, kidneys, lungs, everything's failing. Doctors aren't sure what the problem is, but they know I need to get to a hospital immediately. Put me back on a helicopter, and they fly me to Bagram, which is where the biggest hospital that we had in the country was located. About a 9-minute flight. And it's while I'm airborne that they realize that they had been giving my teammate my blood type, which is O positive. I'm O positive, which means I'm a universal donor, which means that my teammate's fine. But they realize that they're giving me his blood type, which is AB negative, extraordinarily incompatible. So they say, holy shit, we definitely just killed this dude. So, you can laugh, it's okay. I'm alive, so it's fine. So I'm airborne and the docs realize what happened. They call Bagram Hospital and they say, hey, we just pumped Nick full of around 8 units of an incompatible blood type. He was already in critical condition. He really shouldn't have even made it to here to begin with. There's no way this dude survives the flight to Bagram. Impossible. So just be prepared to receive his body when he gets there. In a lot of ways, they were right. I coded completely on that flight. The flight crew were getting real creative with ways to keep me clinging to some shred of life. Panels, shots of adrenaline. I have no pulse, no heartbeat. They pull me off the helicopter. They throw me into surgery. They take my foot off immediately. Dialysis, I'm intubated, transfusion, machines are keeping me alive at this point. And enough of me was still hanging on that they decided to maintain that. And after a handful of hours, 10, 12 hours, I began to come back. And having had a chance to talk to some of these doctors and nurses and other staff that were there at that time, years later, they all say the same thing. Like, we don't know, like, what happened. Like, you were dead, man. You were like real dead. So I had to stay in Bagram in Afghanistan for about 5 days until I was stable enough to survive a fixed wing, a plane flight to Germany. Did that, was in Germany a day. They took my leg off up to the knee, and then after that I was at Walter Reed. Well, I ended up being at Walter Reed about a year. And I'm going to move a little bit faster here so we can get to kind of the core of this. But I want to make something abundantly clear. At Walter Reed, in the intensive care unit, still in critical condition, in that moment, I set my sights on going back to my detachment and going back to doing exactly what it is that I was doing at that moment. That was the goal from the very beginning. At that point, yes, I was made aware, hey, a lot of your leg is gone, you're in critical condition, you could die from all this bacteria that's in your body. And although I'm whacked out on ketamine and Dilaudid and morphine, and I'm in surgery every other day, I could still see with a high degree of clarity what was going to happen. I could still see it. And it was just like, okay, roger that. You guys do what you need to do, and I'm going to be doing what I need to do. Walter Reed for a year. And when you're going through rehab in a place like Walter Reed, which, by the way, is what I like to refer to as the most amazing place in the world that you never want to see. This place is unbelievable. The resources are, of course, state-of-the-art, top-notch, but the human beings that are there are, they literally prove angels exist. You're talking about being completely incapacitated, incapable of doing anything on my own, anything on my own. And as most of us could appreciate, regardless of what you do for a living and how you do it, certainly those of us in the special operations community where hyper type A, hyper competitive, want all the work, want all the responsibility. You call me when you need something solved and I'll solve it. When you come from that type of psychology, that type of mentality, and then you are in a position where you cannot do anything for yourself, that can crush people. But these nurses and these doctors, they come in, smile on their face, regardless of whatever nasty, disgusting task they have to do, they do it with joy and with love in their heart. Unbelievable. When you're in that kind of bubble, it's much easier to remove distractions because there really aren't any around you. You're living in this bubble where all you do is wake up, eat, you go to physical therapy, you go to your doctor's appointments, you eat again, you go back to physical therapy, you go to occupational therapy, maybe you go get a weight workout in. You're isolated. It was much easier for me to do the things I knew I needed to do in that world I was in. But then after a year, I returned home. And I moved in with who is now my wife. Now you want to talk about a wild courting phase. She was in Afghanistan at Bagram when I was brought in. We were close. I can never really say that we dated because we kind of blew by that. But we were just, we had known each other for years. We were kind of in the early phases of like, this might become something real. We were in two entirely different locations. She's expecting me to show up dead, as with everybody. So she had a front row seat to this entire thing. Then I'm in the hospital. She's finishing up her Afghanistan deployment. She goes home. She has work to do. She's visiting me when she can. This is our courting phase. When you guys are used to taking the girl or the guy out to the fancy dinner and you're putting all the nice clothes, like this is what we were doing. Hospitals, surgeries, she's cleaning out wounds for me. I leave Walter Reed after a year, I move in with her. Bold move, Cotton. And I'm home about a week. And I realized within that time frame that it was going to be a lot hotter to do the things I knew I needed to do because I was no longer in that bubble. I have real world stuff going on around me now. So I sat her down and I said, hey, babe, here's the deal. Here's the situation. I am going all in on this goal that I have. There is no plan B. There's no contingency operation. There's no backup. There's nothing. One of two things is going to happen. I'm either going to make it or I'm going to die trying, and I am perfectly content with either of those end states. And I just want to be abundantly honest and transparent with you because this journey that I'm about to go on is going to be extreme because it has to be. That there had never been an above-the-knee amputee to successfully make it back to a special forces detachment and then return to combat. So for me to even have a shot, I had to truly burn the boats. There is no way back. This is it. And I said, let me just break this down to the tactical level on what this will look like for us. There will be no unnecessary dinners. There will be no weddings. There will be no funerals. There will be no hobbies. Nothing. I've developed this plan with my coaches and some teammates and some subject matter experts. It is dialed in to the minute, and I will live this until I'm successful or dead. And I understand if you don't want to be a part of this. Fortunately, she had the strength to remain by my side, Not only was she a support mechanism, but she became a teammate. She was an asset. And it still gets emotional now to think about that conversation, because I look at the beautiful family that we have, and I could see what we have now. I could see it then. I said, I know this is real. I can see the kids and the dog and the white picket fence. I can see all of that. I know that that is in the realm of not only possible, but probable. But I have to do this. And she could have very easily been like, hey, dude, what you're talking about is batshit crazy, and I want nothing to do with that. And I would have been understanding of that. And I think about what we have created as a family and just how easily that could all have been nothing. But I didn't have a choice, guys. I didn't have a choice. I had to do this. Yes, because I love what I do. Yes, because I have a passion behind the game that we play in this world, in this industry that I'm involved in. But I know that that is why I'm here. I know that that's why I'm here. My purpose in life is to be a warrior and to serve a society. I don't have another option. I will do that until I am no longer an asset, period. She was on board. And then what was already a really structured lifestyle just went to another level. Eat, sleep, train, repeat, that was it. I was working as an instructor, teaching combatives, it's a military term for hand-to-hand combat, and close quarters battle. And after about 8 months or so, I made it known to my leadership that I wanted to give it a shot to get back onto the team. They had to hold back their crazy one-eyed look when I made this clear to them. Like, you know you only have one leg, guy, right? I said, yes, sir, I'm aware, thank you. They said, okay. Go take an Army physical fitness test. Just our basic Army physical fitness test. So I do that. They're like, okay, now go do this physical test. A lot of it was physical in the beginning. What ended up being a 12-week process. Disorganized. There wasn't this laid out game plan. My leadership just began throwing the kitchen sink at me. A lot of physical stuff. Then that branched off into cognitive assessments, multiple cognitive assessments. Proficiency evaluations, another psychological evaluation, which is part of the process to enter the community, to enter Special Forces. They ran me back through another one because although no one has admitted this to me, I know with certainty that they legitimately thought I was out of my fucking mind. Which also is fair. You know, just the level of intensity and watching me with their own eyes, dragging myself into the gym for the fourth time that day, in pain, bleeding, sore, bruised, swollen, and just continuing to go and go and go and go and go. They genuinely had concern for my mental well-being. Got me checked out. The psych came back and said, he's no crazier than he was with two legs. I don't know what to tell you. He's good as far as I'm concerned. And at the end of that 12-week process, I was given the approval to return back to my detachment. About 6 weeks after that, I was back in Afghanistan conducting combat operations. And really not much has changed since then. This is back in 2015. So from the point of injury to the point of me returning back to Afghanistan was right around 2 years, which is still really early on in the amputee game. Really early on. I was asking guys that were amputees for years prior when I was at Walter Reed, like, how long does it take for this just to become normal? And the answer varies from person to person. Every injury is different. Every person's different. There's no objective number answer, which is what I was looking for. But what I gathered just anecdotally was maybe 7 to 10 years. I'm at 2, and now I'm back in Afghanistan. And there's a point I want to make here about that pipeline process. When I set my sights on going back in Walter Reed, It was about me. Okay? It was about me. It was very selfish in nature. It was about me going back to an industry I love, me fulfilling my purpose in life, me proving all the naysayers wrong, me proving myself right. It was all that stuff. It was based a lot on stubbornness and competitiveness, and there is no way anyone is going to dictate my future but me, period. I'm coming back, and I'm going to make you regret not killing me when you had the chance. This is what I'm thinking, 24/7, round the clock, in the hospital, even once I get out of the hospital. And about halfway through this assessment phase, this 12-week process, about halfway through, I'm doing really well. I got a lot of momentum. Confidence is really high. I feel good. I feel confident. I wake up in the middle of the night, 3 a.m., panicking, sweat beating out of my chest. And it hit me in that one moment that I was trying to go back to a team. And it scared the hell out of me. And my first emotion was that of guilt. Because at no point prior had I even considered these guys. I was so obsessed. I had such tunnel vision about what I decided success looked like that I couldn't see it. And then it hit me. I walked into work. I grabbed some of my teammates that were local. I made some phone calls with some guys that were off-site doing some stuff. And I said, guys, first off, I apologize because I have not thought about any of you guys once. I need you to tell me, is this in the best interest of this team? Because I can't see it. I'm telling you right now, I can't see it. I can't look at this objectively. I need you guys to do it for me. Because if you tell me right now that I have no business being back there with you guys, I will stop everything I'm doing right now, and I will find another way to live the rest of my life. Because as bad as I want this, I cannot be a liability for you guys. Because not only is it the guys, it's their families, wives, kids. When you work on a 12-man Special Forces detachment, you are literally putting your life in their hands and vice versa, as well as their families' well-being. That's the level of responsibility that you decide to take on if you want to come do this. They say, hey, man, we've had this conversation multiple times. And the answer is, we don't know. We don't know. But we know we want you to keep going. And if, by some chance, you're able to make it back here, we'll take a look at it then. And we will be damn sure to inform you if this isn't going to work. And although I had been living this somewhat insane, structured lifestyle, when I received that from these guys, these are guys that I legitimately consider family, brothers, guys that I've been through some really difficult situations with. When they told this to me, it was like a surge of electricity was flowing through my body, because now when I'm walking into the gym for that fourth workout of the day and I'm exhausted and I'm sore and I'm beat up and all of the reasonings for me to skip this or to go half-ass at this, when all that comes in, because excuses are the most convincing when we're at our weakest point. When all that's happening, rather than me envisioning stepping off the aircraft back in Afghanistan with my arms in the air, celebrating my victory, rather than thinking about that, I was thinking about my teammate's 5-year-old son. And I need to, regardless if I want to or not, I need to do this at 1,000% for that kid. And you want to talk about reframing inspiration, motivation. When we put our loved ones at the forefront of our why, it makes it that much more difficult to go 50%. It makes it that much more difficult to say, ah, the hell with this. I'll make it up tomorrow. It makes it that much more difficult when the alarm clock goes off at 3:30 in the a.m., and that little snooze button sitting right there makes it that much more difficult to press it. I've really been doing the same type of work since. Some things have changed. I've deployed to combat multiple times since that first time back. I did make the transition to Special Forces Warrant Officer, which I mentioned. And I say that I'll continue to do what I do for as long as I can, but more accurately put, I'll continue to do what I do for as long as I'm an asset to my teammates and to those within this organization and to you guys. I'm sure there are a lot of questions in your minds right now. I'm going to address a couple. Most questions really revolve around two. How did you do what you did? And why did you do what you did? So I'm going to get into a little bit of each with the little time we have here left. The how. The more in-depth answer to the how really is the book that I published in January. That is what that product is. But to extract some pieces of it, the first and foremost was clarity. Clarity. Identifying the mission. That was step one. It had to be step one. Because everything that we do between where we are and where we're trying to go is based off of where we're trying to go. Right, the expression, if you don't know where you're going, any road will take you there. And there is certainly value in just starting. Just start. You will learn throughout the process. There's absolute value in that. In the book, I go into different recommendations of how to identify this mission. But the sooner we can grasp that degree of clarity, the sooner we can identify what that mission is, that long-term goal, the sooner we're on a deliberate track to get there. And two words that I've mentioned now a couple times in terms of identifying that mission is passion and purpose. I would argue, depending on the size of the goal, because remember, the size of the goal is commensurate with the size of the struggle. Depending on the size of the goal, if that is something that is not woven with passion and purpose, it's going to be really difficult. I don't use the word impossible, but as close to impossible as I think it gets. Because when you're in love with the game of getting to that point, that is what enables us to get through the struggle, the adversity, the challenges, the setback, the fear, the pain, the discomfort, the failures. That is what will fuel that, a genuine, genuine love of the game. In order to establish a genuine love of the game, it requires a high degree of self-awareness and honesty, something that in today's world is getting more and more difficult to do because we project a bunch of bullshit all the time. Don't feel guilty about it. This is just the way of the world now. This is technology. This is social media. This is fast, the fast ability to project yourself to the world. Because of that, we as a society are losing that internal connection with ourselves. We are losing that internal dialogue. We are losing that degree of self-awareness and honesty because we're so focused on the external. I'm not anti-technology. I'm not anti-social media. I use all this stuff. But this is something that the sooner we can grasp this and get control of it and have that no shit conversation in the mirror, what do you want to do? Who do you want to become really? Not what did I just post on Instagram with 17 filters and some enlightening caption. Forget that. Stop. Like, forget that. Really, what do you want to do? Who do you want to become? And the sooner that that answer comes in, and you own it, and you digest it, and you fall in love with it, now we're cooking. Now we're moving. Now we're able to do all this really, really difficult stuff that it's going to take to actually turn that into a reality. Once we have that clarity, once we have that mission, and it's defined and it's refined, this isn't sequential. It's somewhat sequential, but I'm leaving some stuff out for time. Beyond that, though, is discipline. A word that is used often, a word that once I say it, some of you are going, oh shit, he's gonna talk about discipline. Shit, I had the donut this morning. I hit the snooze button last night. He's going to beat me up here. It's okay. It's okay. Life happens. Life gets in the way. Let me frame discipline this way. Discipline is the exchange of immediate satisfaction for enduring self-respect. Immediate satisfaction for enduring self-respect. Or another way to look at it is oftentimes people are unsuccessful because they give up what they want most for what they want now. This is something that has also never been, it's a strong word, I'll stand by it, never been as difficult as it is today, because we now live in a world where immediate satisfaction is what we know. I want this answer now, because I can get it now. Everything has to happen now. Technology advances, us as a society advances, our culture advances. We can get things much quicker than we could ever before, ever in history of human beings. So because of that, we become conditioned to, I want this now. Giving up what we want most for what we want now. And I could break this down to a level that everyone here is familiar with, right? When we talk about giving up, right? Giving up what I want most. What word is that? Rhetorical question? Don't say anything. Sacrifice. That's what we're talking about. Giving up something we're fortunate to have. Giving that up, sacrificing that, what we want now for what we want most. Friends, let's just say that. You're fortunate to have a group of people that you enjoy spending time with, and they kind of enjoy spending time with you. Maybe. You're fortunate to have that. It's Saturday night. Phone rings. Well, it doesn't really happen much anymore. Text goes off. Hey, dude. Hey, girl. We're hitting the club. Let's do this. Perfect. You're fortunate to have that. You're fortunate to have at least a person who wants to hang out with you tonight. That's a blessing. You're fortunate to have a little extra cash. Yeah, I could go out. I can afford it. I've worked hard. You've earned that. All right, here we go. Stay with me. You have earned that opportunity. These aren't just blessings that come out of the sky. You worked your ass off to create a friend, have some cash. You burned it down all week. You made a bazillion closed deals. You've earned this. Yeah, I want to do this. I want to go out. I could use a cocktail. I'll go out for a beer. Okay. I don't know how many times I've gone out for a beer, and then 4 hours later, I'm dragging myself to the door at 3:30. Like, what the hell just happened to me? Fortunate to have that. In that moment, are you willing to give that up for what you want most? Independent question. Difficult one to ask and answer. It's easy to say, this isn't going to affect that. No. I'll make up that sleep later. I'll eat healthy tomorrow. It'll be fine. You know what? We have all done exactly what I just said. And you know what? It did turn out fine. We're here now. But ask yourself this, a powerful phrase, what if? You can leverage this phrase a lot of different ways. What if you could go back in time? Doc Emmett Brown shows up in the DeLorean, right? 1.27 gigawatts. The Libyans are chasing him around for the plutonium. He shows up. He's like, Susan, get in. We're going to go back 3 years to that time that your friends invited you out, and you did it, and you had a blast. You had no regrets. We're going to undo that. And the butterfly effect that's going to happen because of that one decision will change the entire rest of the course of then to now. You may say, nah, that's crazy. It's just one moment in time. Yeah, newsflash. Life is just a whole shitload of one little moments in time. And by making that really hard decision, by sacrificing on that one thing, It doesn't matter. It's one cocktail. It's one little martini, whatever. In that moment, by sacrificing that and replacing it with something that is in line with what we ultimately really want most of all, those compound over time. Those compound. They build. Not only does the effect build, but our mentality builds. We're able to see in real three-dimensional time and space after we do the hard right over the easy wrong and look back an hour later, 2 hours later, and go, man, you know what? I'm glad I didn't go. I don't need that right now. I feel good right now. It's just in that moment of the decision, do I go right, left, do I go right? Beyond discipline, work. Another word you guys hear a lot, a word that I am absolutely certain everyone here is familiar with. Most people are familiar with work, with putting in work. Some are familiar with exceptionally hard work. Some. And then there is an extraordinarily small demographic of people, many of which you all know by name, that have found access to an entire different stratosphere of work ethic and productivity. For many, it takes or it took some sort of catastrophic, life-changing event to gain that access. For me, it was getting my leg shot off by a machine gun. Okay, that's how ultimately, that was the catalyst for me ultimately finding that. But here's the thing. It is not as if when I was at hospital, Walter Reed, that some scientist came into my room one night and rammed a metal spike into the back of my head and uploaded work ethic. It's not like Neo in the Matrix, like that didn't happen. Okay, and the reason why I bring that up is because it was there the entire time. The only thing that changed was my ability to see it and experience it and feel it and gain access to it. Now you may be asking, well, how do I do that? Because I like both of my legs. Good, keep them. We're going to find a way to get in there without this. And I've learned that it's based off relationships. Stay with me. Three relationships that are like any other type of relationship with any other entity anywhere within your lives right now. It's a two-way street. You can influence whoever, whatever's on the other side of that relationship. You can control what you do. That's really where control actually ends. Control, influence, relationship. Three relationships that once modified will enable access to this superior level of work. First is pain, a relationship with pain. Second is fear, and the third is failure. Now let's talk anatomy here real quick. I did this piece at a medical convention about a month ago, and I treaded real lightly because I was in a room full of a bunch of doctors. I was like, I'm probably gonna mess this up completely, but I will stand by this. That our brain, as amazing as it is, and the amazing amount of things it does for us, has one priority, and that is to keep us alive. Our survival is what our brain wants most of all. Therefore, within that, within our brain, is a security system that has multiple alerts. We'll talk about two. Pain and fear. These are alerts, these are notifications that come from our brain to keep us alive. Pain, the alert of damage or impairment. Fear, the alert of pending danger or a potential threat. There's a reason why if you put your hand in fire, it hurts. You pull your hand out. Your brain doesn't want that. It's causing damage. It wants to protect us. There's also a reason why if you're on a hike and you see a grizzly bear, you get scared. Your brain's like, that thing will fucking eat you. Go the other way. Modification of our relationship with these two aspects of us as humans. Because the reality is that the greatest moments in life and the most progress in life exists on the backside of fear. We just have to be willing to take the risk. Pain, very similar. Most will stop at a certain point of discomfort. Our brain is saying, we've had enough here. We've had enough here, dude. Whoa, I don't like this. Right? You're breaking out of homeostasis, which our body really wants to stay within. This comfort zone, this bubble, this place of consistency, this place of predictability. That's where our body and our brain likes us to be. We, fueled by passion, purpose, our soul, at times have to decide when to say no to that and keep going. You're in the gym. You're on squat rep number 10. Your body is screaming at you to stop. Legs shaking, core shaking, blood filled, muscles filled with blood. Stop. All right, you're done. It's the person that's willing to go beyond that that actually reaches greatness, reaches that next level, reaches that success. And by modifying that relationship and consistency and at scale, and doing so over and over and over and over again, not only is the effect compounding, but our mentality is compounding. We're seeing, we're learning. Man, everything in my body told me to stop, but I did it anyway. I took the risk. Risk of action, risk of inaction. Again, how I advise decision makers, how I make decisions as a decision maker. Risk of action, risk of inaction. Those that do that, take that risk, the effect of doing so compounds, but also, and more importantly, mentality-wise. We look back going, man, that was the scariest thing I have ever done, but I did it. You know what? It really wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. Whether that's jumping out of a plane to go skydiving, or walking up to that strange person you've had your eye on for 10 years. It's scary. We've all been there. Some of you are now linked up with, for life, hopefully, the person that you eventually did do it. That's a scary moment. And on the backside of that is the greatest, most fulfilling moment of your life. Lastly, on work. It is really, really easy to work your ass off when your boss, your friends, your family, your haters are watching. It is much more difficult to do the same in isolation. But it is in those moments of putting in grueling, ugly, nasty, grunting output when no one is around, and no one is caring, and no one's watching, and you could easily skip it entirely, go at 50%. When you do that anyway, when it's just you and your character and nothing else, that leads to the greatest moments of growth and productivity and progress. Lastly here, I'll close out with this. Is consistency. And this is pretty easy and pretty quick. I'm not going to belabor this point. Because it is, if you are great, if you are perfect for a day, you eat nothing but grilled chicken salads, nothing but water, you woke up on time, you went to bed on time, you spent time with your kids, you were nice to your spouse, you executed perfectly for 24 hours and then it stops, that doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Consistency is 1,000% essential. And what makes consistency really hard is because in the beginning of any journey, the beginning of any process, when it's new, it's exciting. You're eager to get up. New Year's resolution. People are springing out of their beds at 5 a.m. Genuinely motivated, excited, happy. Let's do this. New year, new me. Yeah, okay. That same person, where's that person in March? Talk to any gym owner on the planet. This is normal, guys. This is normal. This is what normally happens. The unusual ones are the ones that are still there in March, April, May, June. Because now it's no longer exciting. It's no longer new. Now it's a grind. Now things have gotten monotonous. Things have gotten boring. Things have gotten rigid, structured. The excitement is no longer there. That is the time when you're at the crossroads. The instant you're like, oh, man, again? Decision point, guys. Decision point. Man, really, again? I've been doing this now for like 3 months. Like, I'm really about to do this again? Yes. If you want to make it to that mission end state, yes. Right now, yes. Right now, most are going, nope. Most are off-ramping. Most are off-ramping. And they've got plenty of justifications and reasons why it makes sense at that time. It's not the right time. It's not the right time. I'll tell you, you wait for the right time for something, you will be waiting indefinitely. I just think my wife, my kids, my job, like all starting to sound real convincing in that one moment in time, because excuses are the most convincing when we are at our weakest point. We've all been there. I've been there. And I've off-ramped at times, guys. Lots of times. Discipline, work, consistency. Those are the three things I really wanted to hammer down on here in terms of the how. How did you do what you did? How did you do what you do? Without those three things, none of this happens. And then lastly is the why. And this will be quick. I believe in something. And like with any beliefs, it's down inside your core. And it is really difficult to be convinced of anything otherwise. Religion may be the greatest conceptualize this. Having that faith. Faith meaning a firm belief in something for which there is no proof. But it doesn't matter.